Hello guys and welcome. Today I want to talk about moon bases, moon settlements, and how can we establish a permanent presence on the moon. I will split it into several stages. The initial stage will deal with how can we reach the moon and what do we need in order to get there. And it will also deal with suborbital stations that can be established at the moon that will help both facilitate traveling to the lunar surface as well as to other planets in our solar system, including Mars of course. The next stage will be about establishing a permanent base on the moon. Even if we start with a small base with just several initial modules that will comprise it, we'll move into larger bases until we reach the next stage, which is setting up a full-fledged settlement of the moon with developed industry and going as far as reaching the size of a city or an even megapolis. That part is a bit speculative and quite a lot imaginative. But eventually we should be able to reach the stage where we will establish a full-fledged lunar city and even go as far as terraforming the moon in the future, which is a really exciting prospect to look forward to.
First of all, there are several considerable space traveling programs that have the potential to reach the moon and Mars in 2024 or even sooner. You have certainly heard of SpaceX and the recent progress that they've made in constructing their Starship and developing a Falcon Heavy carrier along with it. Even though it is designed for Mars, it is an extremely viable option for moving cargo and astronauts at least to suborbital station of the moon. Recently, there was an interview with Elon Musk that showed his plan in regards to moon colonization.
Visiting the moon?
Well, this is going to sound pretty crazy, but we're certainly with an uncrewed vehicle, I believe we could land on the moon in 2 years.
SpaceX is going extremely fast so far, quite often managing to complete their projects well before the deadline. So we are very likely to see the crewed mission by them rather sooner than later. Another huge contributor with a particular aim for the moon is Jeff Bezos, with his Blue Moon that is extremely likely to at least fully establish the transportation route to the moon. It has a large goal of establishing a permanent presence on the moon. They are taking a very thorough step-by-step approach that should be a solid foundation for lunar missions. And we are most likely to see them fulfilling the promise of making a human return to the moon as soon as 2024. With their ships being able to haul as much as 6.5 metric tons of cargo with a stretch tank version, we'll get a decent method of transporting all the necessary cargo that we'll need to lunar bases and lunar settlements in the future. Bezos has presented a particular lunar lander on May 9th. It can be refueled by the hydrogen found on the lunar surface in regolith. Thus, it can be easily refueled by processing it. However, the key to mastering the space travel is the Lunar Orbital Platform Gateway. It is an orbital station under development by NASA. It will serve as the initial key base for the moon. It is part of a larger program aimed at bringing humans back to the lunar surface in 2024, with a subsequent mission starting in 2028. The nearest stage of the plan would involve using the new NASA's rocket, Space Launch System, SLS. The most powerful rocket that was built by NASA. It will carry up to 4 astronauts, as well as up to 45 tons of cargo in its most developed iteration. The capsule for it will start its use as soon as 2020, with a manned test mission, sending cargo and scientific instruments first before sending any people as in astronauts. The Lunar Orbital Platform Gateway will not only serve as a launch station for all the flights to the Moon, Mars, and other planets. Its primary purpose is to facilitate the colonization of the moon. This will become possible since it will be fully equipped to function as a remote controlling base for all of the robots and props sent to lunar surface, effectively protecting the operators from all hazards on the lunar surface. First of all, it will allow to discover the best places to establish a lunar base, allowing us to find places with abundant regolith and natural resources that can be used to support the lunar station. It will help with finding a spot that is less exposed to meteoroids and dramatic temperature swings, and possibly near the underground ice deposits that will be possibly used for water extraction, if that would make sense at that stage. The first module, Power Propulsion Element, is scheduled to lift in 2022, followed by a robotic arm, a crew habitat module, and an airlock, being ready to accommodate astronauts in the mid-2020s, supporting up to 4 members per 30 to 90 days. However, the more exciting part are the lunar bases. NASA has already started contacting private contractors in order to determine who of them will be able to produce a reliable habitat design that they can use both on Moon and Mars. It would have to deal with construction of regular shelters, as well as designing modules of the habitat for astronauts and researchers. From all of the projects out there, I personally like the one done by HASL. Even though aimed at Mars, it can work just as well for the Moon. It actually focuses on creating a livable space, which is extremely important if we're talking about some kind of long-term stay and further expansion of a lunar base. First, a number of robots will arrive to the surface, before the subsequent arrival of the astronauts. They will be tasked with constructing a regolith shelter from the abundant regolith on Mars surface, or lunar surface in our case. The most fascinating thing is that the process will be fully automated, and they will be repurposable for several roles, including scouting for resources, excavation, processing, and construction. First, they will scout for the pockets with the greatest depths of regolith. Then other robots will join in, the scout robots, and dig up all the necessary materials. And afterwards, process it to a finer grain. And then melt it to form the shelter layer by layer. After the actual arrival of astronauts to the surface, they will assist with moving in the modules that astronauts brought in into the shelter. Which are then put together and inflated to create a wholesome, protected environment, with oxygen, electricity, and water being supplied for it. The internal space is equipped with movable shells, allowing them to be reconfigured for a number of purposes, including a laboratory, a greenhouse, providing a constant supply of food, a workshop, sleeping quarters, as well as living quarters. However, if we are to build a lunar base, we'll have to consider several environmental factors. First of all, the surface gravity of the Moon is only 1/6 of that of an Earth. And even though it is good for sending spaceships that would need far less velocity to leave the surface, we will eventually have to bring artificial gravity for any long-term stay to be considered. The popular rotation methods proposed for the space stations will obviously be useless and impractical for the lunar surface. But apart from that, there are more pressing threats to staying on the Moon. First is the constant radiation from the solar winds, solar flares, and cosmic rays. All of it can add up to 30 rem per year, which is 6 times higher than that of a radiation worker. The horrible thing about radiation is that it all adds up. Thus, it will bring you along all of the negative health effects, including cancer. Continuous exposure to such dosages will certainly result in shorter lifespan. I would say this is the biggest problem in colonizing the Moon. On top of that, the solar flares can deliver as much as 1000 rem. Fortunately, there are ways to provide humongous protection from radiation by aluminium insulation, coupled with regolith for the bases. Further technological advancements in creating livable bases will certainly contribute to it. The only real threat is the exposure that astronauts may face while traveling the surface. and there would have to be developments in the spacesuits to provide a greater degree of protection. This would be the main reason of why we would have to rely on remotely controlled robots for most of the unmanned operations. There is another way to reduce radiation to have a permanent presence on the moon, that is, building a colonies underground. But before we will dive into it, let me first explain what are the material rewards for colonizing the moon. There are several precious minerals that can be found in abundance on the moon, including silicon, iron, aluminium, magnesium, and titanium. For example, some rocks on the moon are harboring 10 times more titanium that can be found in terrestrial deposits here on Earth. This is a metal that is widely used in the form of alloys in the aerospace industry. It is as strong as steel, but it's far lighter, being twice as strong as aluminium. On top of it, it is almost as resistant to corrosion as platinum. Other uses range from dental implants and joint replacement parts to propellers and parts of the ships due to high resistance to seawater. But probably the most fascinating element is helium-3. It can be found in the lunar soil, regolith, with scientists estimating over 1 million tons of it. It was accumulated on the moon due to the surface being constantly affected by the solar winds. It can be used as a material for nuclear fusion, and I have already mentioned it in one of the reactors that conducts deuterium-deuterium fusion, the one that is being developed by Helion Energy. The energy produced by it is 250 times greater than that required to extract it and transport it back to Earth. And obviously, with advancements in reusable rockets and their capacity, the costs will inevitably go down. Once the extraction and transportation is established and streamlined, the amount of its reserves on the moon can potentially supply humanity with large quantities of cheap energy for centuries. Not to mention that the resource would be worth billions of dollars for those who would control its extraction. The whole reason for it being more efficient than deuterium-tritium is that it releases protons instead of neutrons, that are more easily contained due to their positive charge, and the produced energy can be captured directly from it. There are initial efforts to map out existing resources on the moon, good example being the Moon Express company. The program can be split into three stages or expeditions. The first will be a probe sent to the lunar surface, being the first commercial voyage to the moon. It should be launched next year. It will be cost-effective and will have several initial payloads, including an International Lunar Observatory. The second stage, called Lunar Outpost, will bring their permanent presence to the moon. It will be aimed at lunar poles that contain high amounts of frozen water and valuable resources underground, together with the peaks of eternal light that have nearly continuous sunshine and can provide constant direct communication with Earth. Its main goal would be to set up the first lunar research outpost to prospect water and useful minerals. The third mission, the Harvest Moon, will bring first commercial sample from the moon and will serve as beginning for a business phase of lunar resource prospecting. Moon Express was a former Google Lunar X Prize competitor who has managed to develop commercial lunar lander. Their aim is to have a first mission by July 2020. One of the most developed and intricate ideas for the full-fledged moon settlement that I found was Selenopolis, envisioned by Kraft Erika. It so far coincides with the major points of the current lunar program developed by NASA. But he takes it a step further by explaining how the moon can be properly settled and industrialized. His plan can be split into several stages. Stage 1 is the initial stage of land mapping and synoptic prospecting, mainly for the purpose of the site selection with all of the surface works done by robots and rovers, which is pretty much what NASA is preparing for right now. Stage 2 would be about the orbital station, and the lunar orbit, coupled with the Moon Ferry, delivering astronauts for the lunar surface for the manned missions. The most important thing is that it would be able to deal with far greater amount of samples and research materials than what could be delivered back to Earth. All of this is coupled with automated laboratories and pilot facilities on the surface. He also proposed a modular habitat system, and this phase largely coincides with the current developments at its main points. Stage 3 is when the lunar industry would start. The first stage that Kraft Erika proposed was to establish the initial nuclear-powered Central Lunar Processing Complex, CLPC, in a region that would be best suited for transportation, along with a large quantity of obtainable resources. The first priority of it would be to obtain large quantities of oxygen to support the lunar base. It can be extracted from the regolith, and other materials would follow that. The previously acquired experience in construction and lunar station operation would be used here. This will be the phase for the regolith sheltered modular bases to be established. The CLPC will be able to produce oxygen, silicon, aluminium, iron, glasses, and all other materials necessary for maintaining a lunar colony. It should be able to produce a variety of finished products like solar cells, computer parts, space habitat structures, communication platform structures, antenna, service satellite parts, and many, many more. It will establish a foundation for a full-fledged lunar base. Stage 4 is where the creditworthiness of the venture should be developed. The already established lunar station would be expanded with feeder stations that would bring additional raw materials, with the possibility of remotely controlling them via laser communication links through a series of communication relays. They would employ electric trucks for short distances and even electromagnetic trains for larger cargoes. The distant feeder station should be able to hurl the cargo ballistically to the receiver crater with great accuracy due to low lunar gravity and high vacuum. This is also where the fusion power plants would come in, together with a huge solar power plant that would reach the size of 46,332 square miles, which is pretty damn humongous. And it is about 120,000 square kilometers. However, due to the length of a lunar night, fusion energy would be the main source of power. All of it would contribute to creating a biosphere, Nova Terra, that would be suitable for agricultural and biospheric purposes. At this stage, new transportation vehicles and techniques should be invented and developed as well, as ones that would be better suited for the lunar surface. Stage 5 is the most interesting stage. It is when Selenopolis, the true lunar colony city, would be established. This would grow naturally out of the previously established industrial complex that should be fully able to support it. However, to fully construct it, additional resources from Earth would be required. This can be conventionally done through the already established logistical routes that should be streamlined and developed to high cost efficiency. The underground colony will be completely suited for human life, with the interiors being illuminated by the natural sunlight, reflected through the ceiling by a mirror system, with some of the mirrors colored to provide the same changes in sky colors experienced on Earth, since the lunar day would be 14 Earth days long. The key point here would be Earth simulated climates that would be best suited for growing the food. There would be continental, dry subtropical, and semi-arid. The infrastructure should be that of a completely habitable urban complex, with an electric monorail going through the entire city, subsurface lake, rotating swimming pool, and even snow winter section with ice skating rink. The point is to make it as livable as possible for the comfort for its citizens. Coupled with industrial self-sufficiency, it will be able to fully sustain itself and have a surplus of resources that it will be able to trade with Earth. Not to mention all of the technological advancements that will inevitably be developed as a settlement advances in colonizing the Moon. This is a brief overview of what Kraft Erika has envisioned. For more information on the subject, check my full article through the link below and a link to magazine publication detailing his ideas on moon colonies.
Thank you for watching the video. I really hope that you liked it. If so, please give us a like and subscribe to our channel for more videos like that. The next video will be about quantum computers, particularly about the practical applications of those. I'll talk about how they can be applied in logistics and medicine, as well as in fields of finance. After that, I will go back to exploring other planets, and particularly terraforming Moon and Mars, which is a really interesting topic. And even though it might not happen in the nearest future, it's a prospect that it's really exciting to look forward to.
Also, check out our store. We have a lot of great merchandise with really low prices and really high quality. Thank you and have a great day.